Commission meeting, August 16th. And we're going to open with public comment, but I don't see any members of the public aside from our regular member of Fremont Hampton who's on the agenda. So we're going to move on to approval of previous minutes. As you remember from last meeting, we asked Terry to clean up a little bit of the June 21st minutes. And I think she did a fine job. Under page 2, under goals, she made a 1A and a 1B. And that was essentially what we asked her to do. And then other goals and other reports.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the only change to those. And then if everyone wants to take a minute, because we just received this today, to review the last meeting minutes. Is that terminal?
Any extensions?
Oh, we're doing the 19th?
We're doing the 19th.
Oh.
I abstain.
Yeah, I told them that I abstained last night.
Okay, so two abstentions, Jen and Rob abstain. Is that right, Jen?
Pardon me?
Jen and Rob abstain.
Correct, yeah, yeah.
All right, so that's that. And then the, sorry, going backwards here. Motion to accept the June 21st minutes?
Motion to accept the June 21st.
Give me a second.
I second that.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Abstain.
That's your second. Oh, you're abstaining from that one, Todd?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. All right. Okay. Review of to-do list. Okay, a couple of you weren't here last meeting, but I am asking for now on if folks can bring their laptop if they have one. That way we can pull up the to-do list and you can see ongoing what you've got to do. It's not always enough to just look at the last minutes, because the last minutes only reflect those things that came up at that meeting. So let's make sure we do that going forward, okay? So do we have any questions about Marilyn? I mean, here's the way I want to do this. I just want to give everybody a couple of minutes during the meeting to pull up that list and go, oh, this is what I need to do. Ideally, I'd love for you to do that before the meeting, but I'm being realistic and I want to make sure that there's time in the meeting for that to happen too. Okay? So I'm not actually going to be going item by item down everybody's list. That would make us all crazy and want to put a page on. But I do want to give that opportunity. So since most of you don't have laptops, this is just a reminder for the next time you meet, or whatever devices, you know, iPads, to, well, let's do that as a matter of discipline. Sound good? All right. Okay.
So, did we just review the, are we going to review the tasks or no?
We're not going to review, I mean, you don't have your to-do list.
Well, but I do see one item, Molly and I are going to put down. I missed that.
Okay, so here's what all I want to do is give you a moment during the meeting to look at your list, not to necessarily discuss them and go into those two things, but just to look at them and be reminded of them.
But you don't remember having that.
I'm glad, it's kind of like, yes?
I vaguely remember it, yes.
We're doing that, okay.
Yes, that is on both your lists, that I do remember.
Right, oh, I see it on the list, but I wanted to mention Molly was on my board.
Okay, it's not on my list right here.
It is on your list on the side.
Yeah, yeah, I just checked to make sure that we're doing it.
Okay. Good, all right. Chair report. I noticed some things on my list I have intended to, the main one being to reach out to Wayne Fighton to talk about our relationship to the bike pit. So that is still something that I need to do. But the thing that, the conversation I have been having is with Brian O'Donnell, who is chair of the Transportation Planning Commission. a lot of lack of clarity events have been. I'm still not sure when they will next meet. Apparently they have forum issues in the summer and they don't deal with them as efficiently as duopoles as we would. Maybe we're like skating on thin ice when it comes to open meeting, but it's working for us. So anyway, I will attend the next Transportation and Parking Commission meeting whenever I find out when it is.
It's the third Tuesday of every month and they never meet in July or August.
Oh, is that the way it works? Are you a staff for that?
Not anymore, but I was.
So you used to be
here.
Okay, all right. And then the other thing that I still haven't heard from you though and requested numerous times is to get a copy of the draft updated tracker calling because my hope was to get a hold of that manual, give it to you guys, and have us in an open meeting discuss how we want trees to be included in that manual. I did not get that from them after at least three different requests.
Probably,
so I don't know why.
Probably won't. Knowing Ryan, probably wouldn't want to release the draft. I'd be afraid that it would actually get outside of the transportation department for some reason. That's my thought.
Well, if you just out and say that, that would be helpful to know. Then I just stop hounding him.
I can see my guilt.
Can you please?
Yeah.
Because I have a feeling that maybe they won't meet until before we do. They only meet once a month.
They meet every, so they will meet.
So we will meet before they next meet.
Are we going back to twice a month?
Yeah.
So you'll have one more meeting before their next meeting?
Yeah, okay, so, Richard, do you mind? I think that's it for my chair report. If I think of anything else. That's your up.
Okay, so a couple, always a couple, more than a couple, a few. So first and foremost, Willie and I are giving a presentation, which we haven't even prepared for, at the end of September.
Oh, that's long.
Yeah, well, it's long, I know, but we have a lot of work. This is preparation I'd like to have.
Yeah, yeah, well, you remember, I did a presentation to city council, so that's a good start.
Yep, so, on Tuesday, September 26th, 2017, Willie and I are gonna give a presentation at the Western Mass Chapter, Tree Wardens and Foresters Association. The dinner's held at the Kumana Diner, it's $30 per person. And those interested in attending, listen to our presentation.
Get the turkey.
Get the surprise. So our topic is gonna be the road to Northampton's tree inventory. Basically, the little barber here said that in 2014, volunteers in the Northampton included a sample tree inventory with the goals of understanding the city's trees better and advocating for a proactive tree program. Since then, the tree program has grown and grown. Hear about the newly formed tree commission, how the city used that sample inventory, and the city's new inventory, and how the tree warden and the tree commission get things done. So that's the topic of the conversation.
Pass that little thing around?
Yes, yes.
Can anybody put that in?
Yes, you just have to, you want it, and actually.
$30.
What's that?
Cost $30.
Yeah, it's not free, it's $30.
Is that what I have to say before?
That's correct. Yes. So if anybody's interested in going, possibly can see if we can pay for folks. If you are.
Is it Tuesday?
It's a Tuesday, yes. So a couple other, so as all of you know, there's a gazillion projects going on in town. And I've got a gazillion requests to go look at tree protection. So it's been a crazy summer. But it's been a good summer because I've had a lot of positive interaction with the contractors, the planning department. So I think overall it's been good, but it just seems like it's a lot of construction issue. And then of course the city's starting a maintenance group, which is a two-year, $3 million project that has a lot of basically a complete roadway construction. So there's gonna be a lot of work over there. Plus there's gonna be a lot of tree plantings actually when the project is finished on the Riverside Drive Mill River side. There's probably, I think, 25 to 30 sugar maples that have to be replaced.
On what street?
On Riverside Drive.
Oh.
Opposite of Hinkley Street, where they're actually putting new outfall. So a lot of stuff moving there, but I will keep you posted. The other thing is that we're talking about Forbes Library at the moment.
Yeah, go for it.
So the circling back to the first year of the commission, Lily, Jay, and myself were asked to approach the trustees of Forbes Library to talk about the historic pin oaks / possible scarlet oak, which is can't quite tell, and their possible replacement and what actually we would recommend and how we go about getting them done. Getting either pruned, removed, or replaced, or whatever. So since then, two years later, it's been 2 years now, Forbes Library and the city actually, there was a little bit of a disagreement as to actually who was responsible for the library. But that has been since settled in probate court with an agreement between the city and Forbes. So Forbes is responsible for maintaining their facility, and they're also responsible for making sure that they follow all procurement because of the fact that they are publicly funded, you know, privately run, publicly funded library. So that brought about, you know, reignited the question about the trees in the front, because there's multiple trees in the client in the front of the library. So after a bunch of research, I found that the trees in the front of the library are actually all public trees. They are not, they don't belong to the trustees, they belong to the city.
What line?
Because of the county layout from the 1700s. County layout line is very clear, it's very wide. So most of those trees were planted either on or within the public right away at the time. So that was from a Mass DOT plan that dated in the 2000s.
And did you share that with Lisa, so she'll share that with the board ahead of time?
I did share that, and I actually been, I have sent, because my, what really prompted this the second time around is an email that I got from the mayor about, originally, the mayor wanted myself and David Pomerantz, who's the director of social services, to go over there and talk to the trustees, because we were under the impression that those trees actually were all owned by the trustees, which we found out they were not. So, because they're public shade trees, they're hence the, you know, super protection of the NGL Chapter 87, so they have a different set of rules. So it's going to be interesting to have this conversation with the trustees, but I think, I went over and did an assessment of all the trees, and I determined that five out of the five trees have to be removed. And the largest one is probably 110 feet tall. And that's the one that's over in the side yard where they have all the movies. And that's kind of what prompted them to ask the mayor to look into having the trees removed. And because of the fact that they have a lot of fence over there, and a lot of branches and things falling. So I took a hard look over there and spent probably about a half a day just walking around, looking at the street. I didn't use a resistor graph, I just used a sounding mallet and a probe. And some of the trees that actually look healthy have a lot of decay in the hollow.
Oh, wow.
So I've also made arrangements. I met with Lance Wade from the Arborist National Grid, who is going to assist us with the removals that are over in the side yard. They're actually right over the, they're a three-phase primary. So I think National Grid is going to assist us to actually, they're going to take the lumber and I'm going to have to do it, they're going to bring the grain, and they're going to take the whole thing.
Wow.
For how many?
For two of them, yeah.
So have you scheduled that?
No, because the reason I want to, they're not scheduled at the moment, because the reason I want to meet with the trustees is I feel that because of the historic nature, first of all, we have to have a conversation about replacement before we go right now. Second of all, I feel that because of the historic nature of the tree, that I think they deserve a public shade tree.
Even other hazard trees.
Well, it's one of those things where it's good to let people know ahead of time so they don't.
Yeah.
It's like.
Well, I think it would provide a format for questions and answers for folks that were interested. I've tagged the trees with pink ribbons. With the pink ribbons face the libraries, when you walk out, you can see them, and the ribbons state what's going to happen to the tree. It's either going to be a tree clean, or they're going to be removed. So, because, you know, the city's responsible for them, you know, we need to plan for replacement in conjunction with the trustees. Because, you know, the trustees expressed to us the last time that they wanted the trees to be replaced roughly in the same location, because they wanted to have as much lawn as possible to have their events, which was kind of a little bit of a bone of contention, if you remember. Because they want, you wanted to plant trees ahead of time to get them to actually grow for a few years before we did some removals. But that didn't happen.
I don't know when would be the time to do this.
Actually, I am going to interrupt it.
Okay.
Since this is during the tree warden report, I suggest that we circle back to this and during any other business. Because I do feel like there is something, you know, there are things to be discussed. And maybe a recommendation to be made as a commission.
Sure.
I just want to make sure that we're moving forward.
I mean, really, I don't have a lot. We've just been doing a lot of tree removals. And we've been watering trees regularly. The ones that need to be watered, we've got Terry, how many bags out on that list, do you think?
A lot.
there's well over probably 100, 150. And then as we've been going around looking at all the other trees that we planted a few years ago, thinking to put water back, just put them on and water them. Instead of putting water back on everything, because we've had so much rain. But really now we're at the point where the soil horizon, you know, is very dry. bring water bags on all the time, so I had some staffing issues, so I've been trying, particularly trying to fill seasonal positions, so I have a seasonal employee who's started working several weeks ago with water, plus I have a senior tax write-off person who's working with them, so they're water companies, so.
Couple meetings ago, we asked for a breakdown of the 2017 planting, say, versus public locations.
I owe that to you, I apologize. I think I can do it.
Okay.
I apologize. And that's, we've just been, and again, we've been doing a lot of renewals, just picking off the daily list, doing drains, but this is what all these are. And every meeting I come back with more, but these are just requests from residents, not to mention what the David Tree report says.
This is for renewals?
This is for tree inspections, tree determinations, and then on top of that, I've been spending a lot of time in the field doing tree protection inspections with different contractors, so they're having the site done. Been a busy, been a few years on the reporters over. It's always next year. That's it, unless someone has a question, something I missed, I'm sure I missed something, we'll scatter, just came back with locations.
Where'd you go?
I'll let you know. Nice and green up there. A lot of rain. Oh, yeah, one other thing, actually, I think this was pulled into the forest. This was pulled into the forest conversation, we have an estimate from a company to do the rest of the work, and I just wanted to tell you how much it is.
All right, I think we're gonna have more time than I allotted for any of the business, because the next item on the agenda, traffic calming manual, which I had hoped of when I made this agenda, that we would have something to present here, I don't. So that is completely excised, well, before I completely excise it from the conversation, we could speak about this matter theoretically, although we don't know what the current traffic manual, the calming manual says. Actually, I do know what the current one says, but we don't know what the updated one says. And the current traffic calming manual you can find online, but I can basically tell you that it makes, I want to say no reference to trees. It may make a reference, but it's certainly nothing in the way of when a certain tree, a certain street is identified for needing traffic calming, we include street trees on the recommended actions for calming traffic on the street. That does not exist. What also doesn't exist is there's like a chart that allows you to assign value to various measures to determine a street's priority as needing traffic calming. And the existence or the absence of trees is not among them. And so those are the two things that I thought we could possibly recommend. One is that when evaluating the traffic calming priority of a street, one should also look at the presence of street trees. And I mean by street trees, I mean those that are like immediately on either side of the street. Provide that sort of visual vertical wall that helps slow traffic. And then on the other side of it is when a street is identified, including street trees, as a measure that will help to calm traffic. I'll give you a piece of feedback that Ryan gave me that I found interesting, and I told him as much. Let me see if I can just find it. And I don't know where he came to this conclusion, but he said, okay, the manual deals with how the city will handle citizen-initiated requests to address perceived problems in speed. If there is speeding, I do not think most people will accept the addition of trees as a solution in the same way they would accept modifications to the road in the form of speed bumps, road narrowing, and so forth. Okay, so I don't know if that's just a personal opinion, a gut feeling, any way data-driven. So all I said was, I'm intrigued by the suggestion that citizens wouldn't accept this strategy as willingly as rate infrastructure changes. You know, it sounds like there's some important educating to do, both at the level of the Transportation Parking Commission and the public at large. All more reason to have a conversation at your next meeting. And so now we're still going back and forth about when that next meeting would be.
The way I would interpret that is saying trees are 10-year solution.
Down the line.
People are looking for something now. That's how I would interpret that.
But they're not mutually exclusive.
No.
Speed bumps are proven to cause more accidents than they prevent them.
That's actually not beside the point.
They're the worst thing you can do.
Sounds like you need to go to one of these meetings.
Who is writing the updated?
I think it's Ryan, right? I think it's
Maggie.
It's Maggie Chan.
Maggie Chan.
She's engineer. She's traffic engineer.
Okay, does she have a particular rate infrastructure bias?
Traffic engineer.
Yeah, so potentially.
I think that Maggie is she's really a proponent of tree planting. I mean, she and I even talked about that when we actually worked on Nonsense Street. They have those speed humps that are there because of the lack of trees, especially if going, I guess, westerly, northwesterly, on the right hand side, all that old speed belt where you could have underwire plantings that actually were, you know, 20-foot trees that were 20-foot wide would really create a tunnel, you know, and create that visual vision of just, oh, I gotta slow down because, you know, that's just narrow. So, I mean, I.
For Ivor Comer, you know.
Yeah, is that what's going?
Right. All right.
Can you write that down?
Sure.
So with this being relatively theoretical, I'm wondering if we could turn to Todd, who has all the language. Wait a minute before you. To draft some basic language that could be inserted in the traffic manual that includes the benefit of planting trees. But the benefit of planted trees for traffic calming and the consideration of the presence of trees when evaluating whether a street, as one of many criteria in evaluating whether a street needs traffic calming measures. Just seems to me like either end of those, it are valuable.
What about a short, maybe this was included in the report you said, but just a few citations of studies, you know?
Yeah, and that's what I was gonna show.
Just need a citation, you know, for a couple of studies.
Oh, you mean within the manual?
Like, no, just to give to them, say, hey, you know, this is, because my experience with traffic calming, I talked to a lot of people about it because they know I'm on this commission and they notice all the stuff we've done on South Street. And I have this discussion with them about traffic calming. Most people don't know. And they're like, oh, really? That's so interesting. I didn't know. You know, so.
Yeah.
I just thought that was really cool, you know, so.
Exactly, and I was gonna bring that if I came to a meeting, but I can certainly do it in advance regardless. I think it might be worthwhile actually within the manual to have a footnote.
Sure.
Oh, absolutely.
Of a study, of a, you know, peer reviewed study that demonstrates the traffic calming nature of trees. All right, so.
Did Ryan make any comment as to the connection of this document to the bicycle ped report that the consultants?
But I didn't ask. I wouldn't have known to ask, frankly, in a formal decision. They don't. All right.
It should, because they cost money.
Here's what we may be able to meet again before the Transportation Parking Commission meet, in which case Todd could bring back more language, we could discuss it, we could, you know, vote on it, or that's possibly number one. Or if you like the general recommendations that I'm suggesting, you could empower Todd and me to draft language to submit to the Transportation Parking Commission.
I'm just wondering, does it make sense to try to just put the, what you're proposing is to put the language directly into the bylaw, or whatever.
The manual?
Manual, yeah. But
before, and I'm, you can only do that in a open meeting, and so I'm waiting for the next one, and so they haven't met in 2 months. The thing is, he's telling me, so the last email, was, okay, I had asked him, do you not have regularly scheduled meetings, so I can add the next one to my calendar, and he said, feel free to weigh in with your ideas, I've been working to revise this manual for a long time now, so I won't delay the basic overhaul, but we can always add tweaks later. I don't love that suggestion, and in fact, the way the draft is written would not in any way preclude the DPW from integrating trees in addition to other infrastructure, should the situation call for it. My feeling about that is it's always better to front load and get in, and like be a part of the official, like the city council needs to in any way endorse this, like, no, we're not gonna try to like backfill in our recommendations, that is always, people move on, like they like, oh, that's done, I'm moving on. So I would much rather be aggressive now and try to get our language in there.
So Brett, I propose you draft language and get it on the computer screen, and many people that are going to bring it in for me.
Okay.
I don't know what that is.
Shall I take that as a motion?
As a motion, I have.
I'll second.
Okay, discussion?
Oh, discussion.
Yeah, no, you can second, and then after vote second, come to discussion.
I guess I just have one question, is there someone other than Ryan, is that, I think you, is that right, you're supposed to approach him?
I don't think he's being purposely obstructionist.
No, it's just that time is going by and you might.
Exactly.
I just don't want you to miss the opportunity as it's going by.
Okay. Any other discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Noes?
Sure, oh yeah, sorry, yeah.
You're taking away the speaker.
Okay, it's unanimous then. Thank you, thank you.
Can I ask for a list of the site, the roads or locations that have been identified over the last year or so as from residents needing traffic?
I think that might be, I can send that to you. At least, they had something on the website that I found.
If you copy me when you send, talk to me useful.
I actually have a list.
Okay.
Of what's on there.
Of the priority streets?
Yes.
Okay, then Terry, would that be all right? Just send it to him.
Yeah, great.
Good, thank you. Okey-dokey. All right, review of spring summer planting, so we talked about how, maybe you could just give us some general without giving specific stats. And then a preview of fall planting.
I'm not planting it in the moment because it's too hot. Rob doesn't work in the heat, so my crew is shut down, so they're on strike. But we have, can't remember how many trees we have left.
About 12 trees.
Yes.
We have that are left over from the spring planting. Because of the weather.
So those need to get put in the ground. And then we have,
We did save them and everything, then. When we went to do it, it was one of those, I mean, that 90 degree thing.
And then have 140, at the Mercy Nursery. Coming over to us.
Are those ones that don't have mortgages?
No, we're not worth paying.
140 purchases.
140 purchases.
Which have been tagged and belong to Northampton, but they're just in that.
Which doesn't include any kind of change that you may have because of the four plant.
Okay, all right. So you all feel like you're on target?
We are ahead of where we have been in the past.
Yeah, by a fair amount.
Yep.
So, yeah, typically, like last few years, we had like 30, at 30 left.
Right, and also going into the fall, last fall, we couldn't start until mid-October.
Correct.
So, I mean, yes, we won't go there if that happens again. Once again, we'll have trouble and we'll have trees left over. But it'd be great if we could start here in September. That would be
already a way of pulling up tree keeper and...
Well, I have some, I don't have them all individually. I have, leave them, follow them, and sell tree enter, and then I have a backlog just sitting on my desk with stuff that I have to enter. But I probably could.
You know that...
Some kind of report, I should, I would have to figure out what field I would have to ask for, because the dates, like, if I ask for a date, they would generate a date and show me all the trees and find out that date, so...
And if it would help Green or Hampton have a list of all the setback trees, because you might not have those on here.
No, I don't have, I don't, the only information I have setbacks is what you have given me that you wanted to take.
Right.
I don't, tip, I have not put any setback for him in the tree.
So I guess something we could give back.
Yes, that would be helpful.
Is there anyone that Tree North Hampton could consider, having all the setback, being keepers of all of this, information regarding new setback plantings? And have it in a GIS format, so that, you know, it can be seen on a map?
Okay, so we're thinking about that. Currently, what we do is pretty close, we're pretty close to making that happen, and we can take a photograph of each one, and that has a location on it. Somebody might be able to figure out how to make that location drop onto a map. So that's a step I'll see if we can do. So we do have the list of trees, coordinates.
Spring and summer?
Yeah, we do it by batches, spring, summer. They're not, our intention is to post each tree on the website, each setback tree with a photograph.
There is a map.
Yeah, exactly, so we just need to do that, because we are intending to plan to post each tree on the website. We're doing that because we intend to go back over a period of years, because when people ask how did they do, we won't really know how they did. Let's go, couple photographs, because that will show the growth.
Yeah, and also just that zoomed out ability to look at a map is so helpful.
Yeah.
There are Google spreadsheets now with, they're pretty well parsed out, so as far as the address is there, and I personally don't know how to, what app to use to move that information into a map.
Yeah, send us some, I mean, that's, there's two ways. There's the address, and it might drop the address on the map. But also, when we take the photograph, the coordinates.
Oh.
Or in the photograph, so either way would be close enough for us.
There's an app where you can just take a picture of it and put it right on.
Yeah. That's what...
All right, so Jay, you'll send that to them, because that sounds like exactly what you need. All right, anything else about plantings?
But that information, the species information of setbacks, is some way on your radar eventually? You know what I'm saying? So when we purchase trees, we're not like, holy crap, they just planted 30 acres.
I kind of think what we need to do is, once, I really think the information probably should go into tree keeper, and they should be designated as setback plantings at some point. It's just going to be a matter of loading the data and then assigning, because what will end up happening is that tree keeper gives everything an ID number. So it'll give it, every time I enter a new tree in there, you know, it's 12,300 something, 400 something. It just will give it an ID number automatically, and I just drop it on the map, and it gives its coordinates and everything. And then the pictures, I can take, I can actually load the pictures up, and then you put the species information in there, and put, you know, the condition of the tree, the risk assessment. And then you could assign it as a setback, because they do have a column in the drop-down box that asks for the location. You know, if it's in a tree lawn parkway, the street side, cemetery, and there is a line there, and I can just create, I can create wherever we want. I can say it's a setback, city tree, setback non-city tree. So you could enter it, so we actually could have a running, you know, would work.
So I'm just thinking down, maybe, you know, I know that we're still, like, getting systems going, but in the long run, to be able to have an accurate inventory going forward of species, so we can make decisions about purchasing.
It would be helpful also to understand, you know, even though, it would be helpful to understand where our canopy stands, the percentage of trees. After we've done all these ran out of renewables, and all the other renewables that aren't in our, that aren't in our apartment, I know, which are a lot of maples, lower maples, sugar maples. So it'd be interesting, I agree, it's just a matter of putting it together, what I think.
I'm inclined not to, I mean, I think more if I could not duplicate.
Yes.
I know, and I agree with you, and I have to say, one of the unfortunate things is that because our GIS department has changed now, it's still, Karen Nelson, who took over what Andy Keither used to do, does not do everything that Andy did.
Andy, when you were gone, he said he's on board to help us.
He is, yeah, there was some issue that he's, they're trying, they're using Andy, he's gonna work for IT department now instead of working for DPW. And so I don't know how much of his time he can absorb, so he's gonna work as a GIS person in the IT department, because GIS really, I guess the decision is that GIS really should live at IT. But unfortunately, the DPW has the largest asset management database of any department, and we also supply all the GIS information to police, fire, dispatch. So we're the keepers of the documentation of all the hard raw data that's actual live and correct.
I know we've had, oh, do someone have any? We've had very, very preliminary conversations with us about maybe getting support with insurance or something like that, but are you, but it seems like that, like you sitting down and entering data, it's just a really poor use of your time.
Well, see, but one of the issues, it is, but the problem is that when you actually go to enter the data for a tree, okay, if you, in order to enter the data for a tree, in my opinion, as an arborist, if you're entering data about the condition of a tree, if you're not an arborist or person who's experienced with it, so I'm gonna have to go on the field.
Could we designate conditions of all those trees?
I could, but I still have to go in the field and look at it, so if you're in the field, I might as well just, and basically, like, for example, all the trees we planted this past year, there's really very little risk, there's no risk, and they all need a young tree treatment, period. You know, unless there's something that we noticed in planting that, you know, the root flare was damaged, and we're just gonna kind of nurse along and see what happens. But most of the observations are really easy.
The easiest way for you to enter is to be there and then report.
That's correct.
So you actually take our, that is a.
I take this right out in the field and stand there and just.
So it's kind of bad entry.
But unfortunately, I have, you know, there's a lot to manage, because we're entering all new trees and we're actually taking out a whole bunch of new trees. So every time that we remove a tree, it turns into a vacant site. Even if it's not a place, like, for example, on Sylvester Road, you know, that's not a priority for planting, obviously. But it becomes a vacant site, so it will show up as a vacant site, or a stump, depending upon how I enter it. But it will be a permanent record, and it will be a permanent number. So do we
agree that the idea would be setback trees are included in your grand database?
I think so. I think Jenna's, I'm liking what Jenna's saying about having an overall view of what we planted and actually give us some hard numbers on what our actual urban forest is. You know, we're going to reflect what we've been doing.
Yeah,
right now,
absolutely.
It doesn't reflect what we planted. It does, by entrance and stuff in the street, but it doesn't reflect.
But the greatest diversity will be setback trees.
That's right.
Yeah, that's where there's opportunity.
Yeah,
all kinds of trees.
Agreed. So, we'll have to work on that.
Any more about this topic before we move on to the next one? Okay, we're moving along. Draft ordinance. Hoping that folks got an opportunity to review it. I think the main question is, did anyone reach out to the city solicitor before we go too far down the road with this one to make sure that this is legal?
Well, I reached out to Molly, and I met with her yesterday for about 40 minutes and went over some things that, you know, we would probably want to change and clean up. Obviously, I mean, these things usually take a while to get right. But no, I haven't reached out to this.
I have.
already talking for this conversation.
Okay. So this is a draft. The purpose behind it was to allow the city through the tree board to review and administer any impact to a public tree. And public tree in this case is defined as any tree within 15 feet of the right-of-way, including the trees within the right-of-way. That's one thing we may just have to look at. It appears that Chapter 87 allows you to go to 20 feet in terms of what is planted. So we could change the language to be any tree with any part of its trunk within 20 feet of the right-of-way. And we could classify them as protected trees and regulate them accordingly. But the idea was that instead of fixing and changing all of the permitting processes that already exist around site plans, trench permits, blah, 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 we just create a new permit for people who are looking to impact a protected tree along the public right-of-way, really in any way. And so it's set up with the applicability, what the application itself would look like, including the fee, and what they would have to put in the application, how the application is reviewed with its standards for grant or denial, and then excluded activities not requiring a permit, and then how trees are replaced, either through a DBH equivalent or through a tree replacement fund, which we can add a calculation into that section, which is now, now it doesn't have one. Molly was recommending anywhere between $55 to $90 an inch for a replacement fund. Then it gets into enforcement, penalties, yada, yada, yada. The last section, the other ideas, were just some notes that I was holding on to that I may want to look at down the road, but that was...
You mean the L, M, and N on the last page?
Yes.
So yep. That wasn't what...
It's not part of the ordinance, it was just kind of holders that I wanted to see if were needed to be infused into here.
Todd, what was Molly's overall impression of this concept?
Yeah, I think overall she thought it was good. She wanted to add some standards, the ANSI standards for risk assessment, for pruning standards, etc. I don't know if the city has bought those or if we have a copy of that, that we can add that to the manual. And I've referenced the manual that put together and kind of add those to the manual, so we can just reference the manual and update that accordingly.
And when you say the manual, are you referring to what Jen and Jay have been working on, a very expanded version of it?
Not very expanded. I think adding some references to the ANSI standards, adding some tree protection standards to it, pruning standards and other types of standards to it, then that will update as ANSI updates without any need for additional ordinance passage. It can just kind of update automatically. So yeah, we talked about how some, you know, some towns have regulated trees up to 20 feet from the right-of-way, which Chapter 87 allows. One of the main questions was how do we differentiate between a tree that's actually protected under the existing mass Chapter 87 with the public hearing process versus a tree that falls out of that protection? Do we just make all the trees go through a public hearing process, or is there a way to bifurcate the process to say if it's identified as a public shade tree protected under 87, it goes here, and if it's something else, it has this administrative path here. So that was one thing. That was kind of the main thing that she wanted.
What trees are not included in Chapter 87?
Trees outside of the right.
Oh,
can
this
we
looks
go
nice.
Over?
I have a lot of questions.
I'm really confused by that. So within public right-of-way or 15 feet of said right-of-way.
Yeah, so I didn't get a chance to change that yet, but we could change it to any tree with any part of its trunk within the right-of-way or within 20 feet of the right-of-way.
Okay, so the right-of-way is the road, and then usually there's some distance that the right-of-way goes from the road. Mm-hmm. And is it then 20 feet from the end of that?
Yeah.
So you're maybe 40 feet from the roadway.
So that would be a rare example. But yeah, it would be, I mean, most right-of-ways are, what, 10 feet on either side.
Right, so you have the road, then you have the 10 feet on the other side, and then you're saying 20 feet beyond that, which is actually on private property.
Correct.
So you're capturing a lot of front yards.
You're capturing a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, just saying, and then the other thing is that it actually should have, maybe perhaps it should have said, have any part of the trunk fall.
Yeah.
But it said root zone.
I know.
Okay. I just was checking, because I was getting.
It can be either.
Well, that makes a big difference, because the root zone is huge.
Maybe 60 feet, so you're in people's backyards, you know.
Way further than the drip.
Yeah. Well, we were talking about that, we shouldn't be in the critical root zone, or it seemed the safest language was the trunk, because that's what 87 just says, planting. So you can plant within 20 feet of the right of way, and it can still be a protected tree. So it seemed that the safest was to say trunk, and that was still captured pretty much.
I'm excited, because it seemed like it was including the whole piece of property.
Right.
Okay.
Did they start regulating trees on private property even around?
Well, this does.
Well, the city's already done that with a significant tree protection ordinance. In fact, those trees have zero relation to the public right of way, they're just, if they're on a piece of property subject to a site plan, a special permit or subdivision.
There are lots of examples where we regulate people's property. I mean, think of like wetland regulations. You know, so I don't think that's necessarily a new concept. I do agree with you that there could be pushback, because people regard those as takings, you know, to some extent.
Well, they're going to resist, if they want to cut off a branch of a tree, do they have to file a DLA permit to cut the branch off?
That's a just here, isn't it?
Yeah, well, and that's why it is a draft, so.
Yeah.
Walk through and figure out how to.
I have another question about what this appears to not include. So this appears to not include trees within a park. Is that correct?
Is that a park?
That's covered under MPL chapter 87.
It is covered?
Yeah, I'm waiting for the rec commission to give me a letter. Once they, the park commissioners approve me managing the trees in the city parks, then I have, those are considered under my jurisdiction.
Ah, okay.
So that would be.
And what about, I always bring this back to this case, because I feel like it's the great case that seems to always fall out of everyone's jurisdiction, is the oak tree behind the Academy of Music. Now, I realize that that is, that would be within 20 feet of the right of way, but let's say hypothetically it wasn't. Let's say hypothetically it's not within 20 feet of the right of way, but it's a public tree, but it's not a park tree. And maybe that's just like, okay, Lily found a needle in a haystack. But it was a really nice needle.
What about trees that are on school property? That's a whole other.
That's a whole other story.
It is.
So there are other stories, I mean, to your point, there are other than parks and trees in right of way.
Right, or is it housing authority, those housing.
Housing authority trees.
It's not city property.
That's federal.
That's federal?
Yeah, it's not city property.
So I think, you know, one of the things that, I mean, I'm not, I like this, I think it's going down the right path. I think what concerns me is that the amount of work this is going to create. Amount of work that's going to create, even if I had two or three extra staff. Because you have some homeowner on a Saturday morning that decides they want to prune the tree in front of their house because they're sick of looking through the branches, and they want to see the street from their support. And they start to lop off the branches, they don't have a permit. How?
Pruning is excluded under section 20-34A.
Yeah.
I know, but the thing is, though, is the problem with that is that if people prune trees and they prune them improperly, then 5 years down the road, that tree is going to have a huge, could have a huge defect in it.
Okay, but that's happening already, and.
I understand that, but I think trying to, whatever we do, though, I think we just need to be careful, because you have to think about the amount of work that we're going to create for myself or my predecessor or whomever. Because right now, managing what I'm managing at the moment is a lot.
Okay, so I think that maybe the way to approach this is, what are the activities that generate the greatest risk to trees that have public benefit? And then what are the regulations that we need to create to address those highest risk activities?
Construction. construction. Northampton is off the map with construction, especially with the changes in zoning and people actually selling off their lots that were non, you know, and that's created a huge problem because people can just go in now with a building permit and they can, it just happened over on Blackberry Lane. Guy bought the whole house, had a huge lot in the back. Now he divided it because the lot is now conforming and he cleared up the whole thing. So there was probably 15 trees that were 20 inches in diameter and just got cleared up, gone.
Wow.
So those are the kind of things that, you know, that Brian brought up. I don't know if they thought about that or I don't really know what they thought about because I wasn't part of it in that conversation. But that impacts me and the city in such a way that there's now construction happening. So any public shade trees that above those types of property are at a higher risk of damage. So even if I don't have control over what happens with people that get issued building permits, they can do what they want because their square footage is below 2,000 square feet. There's not much I can do presently.
Exactly, which is why we're having this conversation.
But I think it's really a lot about its construction.
But you can't make this triggered by construction permit. That's the easy thing to do is before filing the permit, cut them down. Which is what I want.
Really, in my opinion, what should happen is that if we're going to issue a permit for construction, the contractor, the developer, needs to provide a report from a certified arborist inventorying the trees that are on the property, sort of like what they do with the site plan review, but a smaller version.
But without the law,
yes,
there's no stopping a developer, and word would spread very quickly that you're going to institute a new requirement for a building permit. Oh, I got to survey all my trees. Well, guess what? There's my building permit. I don't have any trees, so I just don't know that.
So you're saying this won't stop that?
No, this does. This stops that within trees within 20 feet.
Yeah, within 20 feet of the roadway. So the other question that I have, though, is an Alan Seawall question. Is it really truly, is MGL Chapter 87 really truly, the way that it defines a public shade tree is on or within the public right of way. It does not say 20 feet within the public right of way.
But a municipality can always pass laws that strengthen the given state law, as long as we don't weaken it. That's what we're doing. We're strengthening.
That's correct.
Yeah, I mean, so he can say, well, MGL doesn't, you know, but as long as we're not weakening MGL 87, I think he's going to be covered. So it seems to me that the first thing is to make sure that this is legally followed.
Yeah, it seems to me like there's going to be a huge hue and cry of people saying, wait, this isn't on your land. How can you come into my tree? I can't get down a tree. It's on my land.
Yeah, but we've had those conversations before, like for example, remember Molly when setbacks from wetlands. You know, in some parts of the city it's as close as within 8 feet of wetlands, in some parts of the city it's as far back as 100 feet. And that impacts what someone can do on their own property. And yet it was a city priority to protect area on private land, to protect habitat on private land. So I feel like we'll have to face that for sure. There will be some people that say, you can't tell me what I can do with my property. And other people will say, actually, this is a public resource. We all need to breathe. We all need the shade. We all need the wind and the protection or what have you. And therefore, it's a priority.
With this, let's say this went through, somebody wants to put solar on their house, they don't need, do you need a building permit for that?
This isn't triggered by a permit, this is triggered by your action with a tree.
So or with the ground, right? That's with their roots on it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So if someone wants to take down a tree, if they're putting up solar, they can't do that without
or a tree within 20 feet of the road.
Right, if the tree is within 20 feet of the road, I can't do that without permission, or else it needs some
And how would this, how would they know that?
The same way people know that before you put on a big deck that's over 4 feet in the air, you better get a building permit.
So it would be a permit that would be looped into building permits. It would be a standalone permit on its own, but it would be tied to building.
Before any building permit, trench permits, site plan, A&R, lot, or anything, yes. Has to just.
So that's how that would be triggered that way, and then, you know.
I have a couple of questions. So it talks about certificate of exemption, but in B there, but it doesn't mention it anywhere else in here. So what's the criteria for determining whether somebody goes with the permit or gets a certificate of exemption? I'm looking on B, right on the first page, under the.
The review of permit applications?
Right here. It says permit, certificate of exemption.
Yeah, so then it talks about what is the permit, and then it gets into the review of the permit applications, and then gets into the standards for granting or denying.
Right.
So I think it could put some additional clarity in that section.
Well, okay, so what is a certificate of exemption? It's not really addressed in part.
Okay, yeah, we can.
And how would that be, if somebody, whoever's reviewing this, how do they decide if the person gets a permit or a certificate of exemption?
Well, we'd have to add additional criteria.
Right. Well, that just seems like something that should be added.
Right, that's why it's a draft.
Yeah.
What's the, is there that diameter?
No, there's not. That's the tricky one.
Yeah, I was asking about that, too.
Mass general law is what, an inch, inch and a half?
Yeah. That's not going to be.
Probably not.
Mass general law is an inch or an inch and a half?
Something like that.
Right, in your public hearing, it's an inch and a half.
Wow.
Which is designed, obviously, to capture newly planted trees. So we could make it so that it is an actually newly planted tree by the city. You know, and have some sort of, you know, identified within the database. I don't know, but, and we could then broaden the DBH to something more reasonable.
Yeah.
Well, we're large, we cut down the work level for quite a while.
Yeah, if we had a threshold, if we had a size threshold, it would, although that means, in theory, correct me if I'm wrong, that any of those trees that you all just planted, in a couple of years, let's say if it's not triggered before 5 inches, in a couple of years, folks could just really know that they're down this tree.
Right. Not according to the documentation.
That's what you guys can say, 2 years, public tree for 2 years.
It's up to you. It can be a public tree forever.
No, in the setbacks.
I know. It can be a public tree forever if the city so chooses.
Okay.
That's what Bobby was saying. Any tree planted within 20 feet of the right of way.
Currently, it says 2 years. The document was signed.
So you don't have to go back and prune it and manage it.
No, but the homeowner is responsible. If the tree is damaged or gets removed, they're responsible to replace it after 2 years.
Okay.
No, up to 2 years.
Okay, then take a look at that. Bring it to us.
It's 1 1/2 inches in diameter, 1 foot from the ground.
This is MGLA for some reason.
Yep. And bushes standing in public ways.
All right. Okay, I'm going to suggest that we zoom out a little bit and look about how we want to go about discussing this further. Do a couple people feel like they want to work with Todd on refining this and bringing and bringing more feedback for the committee to consider? I find that a group of 10 people around a table working through language is challenging. I'd rather see a couple of people really dig into it with Todd and make some progress, bring it back to us, have us react to it, sort that back and forth. The first step being checking in with the city solicitor and make sure that this is legally.
I think the first step before we do that is checking with the mayor. Because the mayor is the authority that's going to say this is going to be, he's going to be
political.
And I think
that might be one of the mayor's first questions. then maybe give him like a little bit of a menu of options, you know, we could have a size limit to some of these trees, we could narrow it to construction, we could have, yeah.
Todd, in your conversation with Molly, did you mention the other communities in Massachusetts that have any kind of permit ordinance?
Cambridge.
Is that where you got, you get some of the language from that?
That's the Alderman part?
Yeah, I think so, is that in there still?
Yeah, Alderman's in there.
Yeah, there was a couple others I stole from, but.
I mean, so I mean, it's been, it's already been vetted through, obviously.
That's a good sign.
In Massachusetts, so it is a good sign. I mean, I don't know, I think maybe refining some of the language with the smaller group of folks and bringing it back and giving it to Alan and see if it's doable before we even hit the mayor's desk. The mayor needs to be aware of it though, because Alan works with the mayor.
Well, okay, sure.
So that's the only thing that I would like to make sure, you know, I don't want them, I don't want it to be 7 days before election, but it's now, all of a sudden they show up with this document.
It's not gonna happen.
I understand that, but I'm just thinking outside the box, you know, like that, like we had a.
Yes.
Can I just have one more comment?
Sure.
I don't want to get involved in the whole process of vetting thing, but I just want to put one other thing in.
Sure.
Under the standards for grant or denial, that's page 2C. I just wonder, I just want to put out there, what about the idea of the trees and invasive species? Could that be a reason why somebody could cut it down? You know, if they have an ornamental, if they don't like it, could they cut it down and maybe they want to replace it or maybe not, I don't know. Yeah, we would like to something say about that.
Sure. One question.
As defined by, you know, there's standard you can use for how they're defined, I think.
That was the list. State list.
All right, is there anyone here in the commission or members of the public who want to dive into this a little more deeply? Todd, I'll be happy.
And I can refine and bring a more nuanced draft at some point in the future.
And maybe without sounding old to you, but some à la carte options for like, you know, soft, medium, severe. It may just make the mayor feel like there's options.
Yeah.
And it's up for discussion. I do imagine that we'll need to build some political, some education, public education for the world around us. It won't come like that.
No, it won't, and we already have probably some of the highest permits. Our trench permit is the highest one in Western Mass.
You mean cost?
Yes, cost, so I think an added cost to folks trying to do construction.
Where'd you get $50 from?
Data pulled out of the air.
Okay. All right, well, it always just tests how that goes over.
I think whatever, yeah, I think whatever the permit, you know, this is obviously a conversation with that. Permit issue reflects what's going to cost to get it done.
Right, so I don't know how the city does that. I know some cities, the staff does it, files it with the city every year, and that's just it, but I don't know if this is all in the ordinance or not.
I think one of the things though that also is the, because Northampton is kind of unique with all their right-of-ways, every street is a different measurement, it requires a lot of legwork to figure out exactly where that 24 or 15 foot is going to go right-of-way.
Yeah, on them.
Yes, on them, but they will need to, you know, there will be some information.
Yes. To get access, you've got to contact the DPW, and then they have to contact somebody else. So ultimately, it's.
And then the library trees, the right-of-way goes way back then, who couldn't get, and nobody guessed that.
Yeah.
It took me a few hours to find that.
That's what I mean.
I looked, I mean, there's all kinds of information, but.
Correct, most people who buy a house have a survey.
Yes, but I'm gonna tell you a little story over on Fern Street.
My street?
Yep. There was a house that we had, this is a conversation, it took 2 seconds, we ended up actually having this tree that we originally worked on back in 2010. A woman called and asked if we would either come and trim the tree, remove it, whatever, because it's dying, which it was. I went over there because I couldn't find any records that they had, other than Terry had an old work order that actually determined whether it was a public or private shade tree. So I went out there and I found the property plans. The property plans told me that the tree was by a mile wide. So I called the lady, Terry called the lady back and said the tree is wide, blah, blah, blah. And the woman was very polite, very frustrated. So I went, Terry's like, back out there again. Something's just not right here. Terry was very, Terry's very good about keeping me in the straight now. So I went back out there and I brought an engineer with me. It turns out that the street has concrete bounds, granite bounds actually, but actually, so granite bounds are really what determines if they're still in existence, what the actual right-of-way is. IPs or iron pins are, you know, a second below that. So that tree was, it's passed away now, but I mean, it was. So the property pins were incorrect. So the problem with that is that survey, so, you know, someone who does a survey, or they take a survey that's already been filed in the registry of deeds and they reuse that survey and go find the pins from the same property 30 years later, that's not necessarily a true and accurate reflection of what the public right-of-way is.
The surveys don't always say how wide the right-of-way is.
Right, so that's a perfect example of why you need some leeway with something like this, because she could have lawfully, in her view, by looking at the pins in her survey,
she should have cut it down.
But she would have been in violation of Chapter 87 and would have had a, you know, would have swept in and fined her and
sent her off to jail.
She's a nice lady.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't have fined her. It's just the amount of effort that it took to do that one determination.
I think that's not a small issue, and I think we hear you.
Yeah.
That you're concerned about the load this would have and the chaos that could ensue. We have to think about that one.
I like it because it just gives, because right now it's like, I feel like I'm going over here for this developer, you know, and then there's tree requests from folks. If there was a process that really was made it much easier and more streamlined, then it would be easier, I think. But it was going to take a few years.
Could this ordinance in any way conflict with the current significant tree ordinance? Like, if you have a significant tree ordinance, significant tree that falls within the zone.
Yeah, I gotta look at that.
Mesh.
Yeah.
All right. I think you can move us along because our time is up on this item. So do we have clarity about next steps before you? Are you not ready to just run this in the most vague kind of way by Alan, even letting the mayor know this is a very introductory conversation about an ordinance?
I can just call Alan and have a conversation with him on the phone. And then probably, you know, kind of tell him exactly what we're looking into doing. You know, what kind of information is going to need from us to review it and tell us whether or not it's,
and maybe just let the mayor know that this is a very introductory stage that we're at.
Exploratory.
Yeah.
Exactly.
All right. Moving right along. Final review of the recommended tree guide. Is it the final review?
Okay, you're all alone.
You did not print out copies, but it was sent to everybody.
Yeah.
I did the copy sent to
you. You didn't?
Really?
Because I told you to send it to the commission.
Sorry about that.
Actually, Terry, I thought the agenda.
No. Okay.
It's a public, it says here.
Sorry.
a little cute thing.
No.
Cute parts.
Cute parts here.
This is the final.
That's, no, that's the whole, that's the Vermont tree.
That's the Vermont.
Right, right.
I don't want to waste all.
It's beautiful.
Right. Yeah, yeah, so, sorry, I was.
Changed this.
So.
I guess I should have finished the show.
That's all right. If anyone needs to sidle up next to my computer, they're welcome to.
Is that copy?
Does anyone else have a copy?
I have, I have a copy.
I can make a copy of at least the actual list, but it's only the actual list of the trees that you recommended, it's not the actual.
Attached.
The attachment.
That's all right, I can explain.
Okay, all right.
So, Jay and I worked and created this list of trees. They got put into a chart, three charts, small, medium, and large. I did, the wording on it says genus, species, and then comments, I think, and that's not really accurate. It should be common name, scientific name. So I already have that, that's going to be changed. And then we attached a section of the Vermont tree guide. So we didn't attach the whole thing. We attached a section that has the descriptions of all the trees and the key for that. And then there was a sheet that was site analysis, a single page site analysis. And then there was a one-page thing at the end that's old, but it's kind of the best that we could find for planting guidelines for New Mass. So we just scanned that. So I don't know, but
so these pages are just scanned from the Vermont.
It's a PDF.
Yeah.
Selection.
Yeah.
It's literally taken right out of the Vermont tree selection guide.
So the information could be taken from the Vermont guide and moved into our previous type of time or copy them and move them up.
Or if somebody wanted to, you know, retype it. I mean.
Right.
We just, like, it's a big project to, like, you know.
Do you mean all the icons and everything?
Or the icons.
Did you mean the icons? Move the icons?
Yeah, yeah, we can move the icons and description from Vermont list into your list.
Yeah, so basically what you're saying is you can just recreate the fields that exist in Vermont tree guide. And that, I'm assuming that's an Excel document that you made that, our list in, is that an Excel?
You know, I have to ask,
Alicia?
Alicia helped, Alicia did that.
It just be a document, like Word document, Word document.
Right, so a lot of the descriptions and like icons could be moved right into this. And that would create a different work in the document.
It would.
It'd be a lot of work.
Well, the other thing is, you know, we were kind of going back and forth early on about simplicity versus like how much information. So that the number of pages that we included, like that Vermont is like, I don't know, 10, 15 pages, you know? So are people really going to look at that list and say, oh, Amber Maple, and then, you know, I don't know.
Right.
If it was kind of, Todd's suggestion was it's got to be like this thing that the average user is going to look at and say, okay, here's the trees I can pick from, you know? And because originally we had a document that said, here, go to these two websites and use the Cornell guide, which is this thing, and use the Vermont guide. So that was there was a discussion about that too, whether it was the original, that discussion was that people may not understand like how to use it or whatever. So there was a request to include species specific information in the actual physical document that happened.
And I think that's fine.
I mean, I'm not married to anything.
I think that this just needs to clean up the readability of it. And I don't think we're actually that far, and I really want us to execute this project and to do a good enough job, not a perfect job. I'm, like, perfection is not on the table in my mind. We don't have the resources, this project's been going on for a long time, I'm ready to execute. But I think that a few tweaks could bring it up to snuff. Like, for example, you know, assuming that the average reader is kind of clueless, you know, parenthetically after your heading, small recommended trees, medium recommended trees, and then large, you could just say, for, you know, for detailed descriptions of planting guidelines or whatever, see pages, whatever, 13 through 20.
To be a reference.
Make sure that the folks know that those.
Oh, 13 through 20 in our doc.
Yeah, in our doc.
Detailed description.
I just made up those pages.
Right.
We should create like a how to use this guide.
Yes, without it being so complex that people just skip that page.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so that's one. And then the other thing that.
Hold on one second.
And then the other thing was, when you jump to Vermont Tree Selection Guide, those pages starting, I don't know, whatever it is, page six, I think that there needs to be a heading there that says, because we're not in Vermont, and the average person could just look at that and go, huh, like, why am I looking for Vermont? Say, above that, say, yeah, Tree Selection Guide, or we are using guidelines per the Vermont Tree Selection Guide. Like, Northampton is using guidelines per the Vermont Tree Selection. Just to let them know, oh, okay, then I can pay attention to this.
Yep.
Just assume that no familiarity with what the Vermont Tree Selection Guide is.
Yep. So, like,
everything needs to be.
So, let me just ask you a question, Lauren. So the guide, in the present form, the trees that we've selected, if you are someone who doesn't, who's not, it's just a homeowner and wants to use this guide, they're actually going to have to go to another book to actually see what the tree looks like. So one of the things that I like about the Vermont Tree Guide, and I know that we are close, but this is pretty self-explanatory. Of course, I'm a tree person, and so are most of us, and all of us. So I'm wondering if, and I know you want to execute this thing, what is the possibility of taking the guide that you have written and just, like Rob suggested, and just taking the small, medium, and large trees and putting them in a document and have the same criteria? This is already made. Can we extrapolate this format so people can use it so they can say, oh yeah, look at this, this is a round, this is an upright. No, this one likes upright, okay, so this one doesn't. So because the only thing I'm saying is that visual, it's a lot
is
of
that
visual.
The main thing that you want is the form?
Well, I think it would, no, the information I think is important to have all of it. I mean, if you're actually on, if you give this to a landscape architect or someone who's not a landscape architect who's charged with, you know, designing something for a project, you know, they're going to have to either get on the internet and start hunting around, or they're going to have to get another book.
Why do they have to get another book? Because we've listed the names, and then down below, to have some visual. Well, except for, you mean beyond spreading upright columnar.
Yeah, because even now, when I talked about tree selection with Rob for picking trees, I spent a lot of time actually outside of just words, and I actually look at the tree, its form. I look at Missouri Botanical Garden has a huge web page that's totally chock full of a lot of trees that we plant here.
Why don't we just give a link to the specific really helpful websites like that?
I mean, you could to make it easy. I mean, I'm just thinking about the visual aspect of it, and handing even the old list that we had that was from the commission was helpful because it did, you know, small, medium, large trees, explain what sizes they grow to, their average spread, and then, you know, drought tolerant, DT, salt tolerant.
But this has all that, right?
Vermont Tree Guide has one.
Yeah, and she's captured.
You have, but I'm just.
I assume she's captured all the trees that you've mentioned.
I guess the question is, will our guy could be there in the day?
And I'm not trying to make it more difficult to get this launched, but I mean, the question is, do we want to launch it in such a way that it's?
Can we launch, you know, version 1.0?
Sure.
And then we can improve it, because we're not a tree publishing company, and we don't have a graphic design person on staff. And, you know, all the information is here, it just needs to be, a person does need to go, oh, I moved from this chart down to, I gotta find out what the scientific name is, and then go find it on this list and read about it. It doesn't have an actual photograph, that is true.
No.
But the little symbols are very helpful.
I think they're helpful.
So the question is, once we approve this and move away, is it possible, if we don't change the content, but just the format, to just reinsert it without getting all sorts of new permissions for wherever it went? I mean, because you're gonna get this to be part of another document. This is gonna be part of the guide for.
Yeah, eventually, yeah, be part of it.
So I guess what's listed in the manual, can we just insert?
Yes, the planning commission and the city council should adopt the official tree list as may be amended from time to time to allow staff to amend it from time to time.
So, Norm, if you go ahead with this as it is, you could then make this more ideal version of the commission and adopt that.
Of course.
Put it in there without.
Or some volunteer, you know, really.
Write a grant for, I mean, it would be a lot, it would be, I mean, somebody could do, I mean, you could easily use that information and make whatever you want, you know, but that's not me.
I think we can do it later, because everyone's like, if you're doing it later, insert a more finished graphic version, without having to have things be voted.
I think for the short term, I hear what Will is saying about getting it launched. And I think in the short term, the important thing is to get this list of the trees that we'd like to see planted out there.
In the hands.
In the hands of the planning department. So when they turn around and give the information to developers, there are zoning requirements which they can just adopt without going to city council. You know, these are now the trees that are gonna be planted, and this is the tree selection that you have. And then maybe we should come back and try to figure out how we can, because we are gonna have to amend this, obviously, based on new tree species that are gonna work, climate change, you know. And then work to put a format like this together. We gotta find somebody that can do this, because there's none of us at this table, I might think, have the time, and I know I don't have the expertise. It's almost like we would actually have to maybe either get a grant for this or pay someone.
Millennials know this stuff really well.
Or an intern. Or the other thing that we can do is that I got an email the other day from a gentleman at the Conway School of Design. So this could be a project that maybe they would be interested in tackling.
Maybe not.
I don't know. I have to call him and just have a conversation.
Yes.
Just give some introduction.
Okay.
I don't know. Anybody have any thoughts?
This is $7,000, quick one. It's a $7,000 project, actually. It's not the end of the world.
I think it's less than that. I mean, I think they're making.
For a commission our size, we need to be doing a $7,000 quality tree planting list. I just think that good enough is going to be fine. And this has all the information. It just doesn't have it all on the same page. It's pretty close. It's only 26 pages. And you just need to move from that original chart down to whatever scientific name is of your tree and learn about your tree.
So I could actually create like a table of contents.
Yeah, or like how it said, a quick how-to.
Yeah, quick how-to, and then for each tree that's listed there, if there is a reference page within the Vermont Tree Guide, make sure that, you know, for more information, see page 21.
For each tree.
Yeah,
what do you put it under the notes column?
Yeah, and in the notes column, for more information on this tree, please see page this.
Put on the how-to, right? Look up the scientific name.
Yeah.
or, you know, that column could be called details about this tree. And then you could just have in that column, page six, page eight, page nine.
Oh, yeah.
Keep it really simple.
So that way there you have, instead of people looking at the first three, four pages and saying, well, look at all that, what is all this over here? You know, they can say, oh, I, you know, sugar maple, I can go to page 21, and, oh, this is not any good for really, you know, street tree planting, it's not good for open spaces, blah, blah, blah. And then you go from there. It would be a quick, I know it sounds quick, but it would be a quicker way, and that way there would, you can deliver it, and it can be usable documents sooner than later.
And all that's just to help.
Yeah.
I mean, the legal thing is the list.
I think that, I just asked someone how long this might take, unlikely, 6 to 10 hours, but it really volunteers, Mike, you can approve this, find the form that the information is correct, whatever you want, approve it, send it on. Over time, our volunteers that are part of the community might go back over it and make it look completely different.
But let's in the meantime get a 1.0.
Yeah, yeah, no, I'm saying, do the 1.0, but I'm just saying that don't worry about it, because I do believe that it's gone back over again, if that's an allowable process.
Okay. So can you bring back to us next time, up in 2 weeks, just instead of that column that says notes, it says details about tree, and then C page, that, you know, for each one.
Or just have a column that says C page, and that's the cover.
Because the notes are.
Well, I think.
And then you've got separate one covers.
Taking out all the notes might not be so good, because.
We could probably just put another column on there that says details.
Because the overplanting part, the overplanting part won't be in Vermont.
Did we get permissions from Vermont to that?
You don't have to.
You don't have to.
Yeah, I looked into that, I went to the library and it's, because it's usually a courtesy that you say, you know, this is where the information came from.
I have one.
She said it was fine.
All right. We're 5 minutes behind, so it's.
I know.
I heard you, I totally heard you. I'm just letting you know that we're 5 minutes behind.
It's short, it's short.
The other half of my sentence is, so we'll take Molly's last comment, and then we're gonna wrap this up.
All right. It's just, I haven't had a chance to, it's good, it's all good. On the list itself, this horse chestnut is listed both on the median and large and not the coastal.
Oh, it is?
Yes. And also, not to not that one.
And, what was that, I like that.
Pearl.
Catch, you, that's really scary. Totally worthwhile, you fighting for that.
Thank you, that's exactly why I wanted you to look at it.
Saved a small child from poison.
That's good.
Okay, all right. Tree Ward Hampton, if you wouldn't mind wrapping this up in 6 minutes if possible, because we do want to discuss forest fire.
All right, we'll go quickly. The highlights, we're continuing to keep an eye on the trees that are in the Bedursfield Community Garden. There's quite a bit more work to do there. It kind of got hot, people started going on vacation and doing other projects. So, but that's still ongoing. Still in need of wood chips, so that's one of our next steps. Oh, you've got that covered, fantastic. An exciting new project came up recently. Yesterday there was a workshop, which Jonathan will talk about, and I'll take three and then he can have three. So I'll better get going. The, a group of residents from Village Hill contacted Rich about the state of their trees up there. And he and Rob went and met with them, and they and explained that pruning, which was their thought, was not to be done until the trees are more dormant. And however, they identified that there is a serious issue with volcano mulching up on those trees. So the residents are organizing themselves. They have a group. They're being led by Bob Haxby.
Oh, yeah.
And Rich and Rob spent time with Bob and another one, Mindy. I haven't met yet. And then Rob and I went up on Saturday morning and spent time with a group of residents. And we worked on three trees, three of the in the oldest section, the trees that were planted the longest ago, and it was quite the project. They were very impressed with how much work it's going to be. They had about 70-some trees.
Well, here's a full room, so when you pull back, it's like, I think that's...
Bob did a wonderful job of writing up a report and distributing it throughout Village Hill about what had gone on, about how we came up to Northampton and led their group. And then he has links, and they have sign-up software, and they're really getting organized, and they're really going to work on this. And he learned a tremendous amount. He's obviously been on the internet doing some homework, learning about girdling and all of the ills that will probably visit those trees if nothing is done. So they're really engaged, which is fantastic. There were a number of different developers over time on the Village Hill.
My opinion is not volcano mulch. My opinion is poor planting. So whoever planted the trees didn't bother to take the soil off the top to get to the roof there. They just planted them. And they didn't plant them very deep.
Is this the one street tree? Are we talking street trees?
All street trees.
Okay.
So I've been up there looking at different things, and I walk around. There's so many different maintenance groups there that some of the maintenance groups do a really good job of putting mulch on in a very thin layer. But because the soil is so built up to begin with from day one, that they're just putting it over the existing, but it's 10 inch thin because they're just using a bark blower. The other trees in other parts of the Village Hill are not taken care of at all like that, because other groups don't pay for that.
That was a special permit, right? That's a big...
Oh, yeah.
It's got conditions and all that.
Yes.
And I bet as part of the plan set, there's a landscape plan, and as part of that landscape plan, there's a planting document.
Yep.
And if they're in violation of the planting document, then the building commissioner has the ability to go and enforce that to help recoup the fees that the city is going to have to pay out and fix the problem.
But I never reviewed any of my stuff. Well, I shouldn't say that. I'm reviewing them now. Okay.
But I can guarantee you there's a landscape plan and a ANSI approved standard of how to plant a tree.
I thought that was a problem if it wasn't.
Well, whatever. There's always a thing on a plan of how to plant a tree, and it doesn't have it, you know, planted 4 feet right away.
But I thought we went over this, and the problem is it's not enforceable because there's no standards.
It's on a plan, stand by a landscape architect, and approved by the planning commission. Therefore, that is, and if they're in violation of anything in the plan, that's a violation of the special permit.
Right, I understand.
Okay. Just make sure we get out of here for six.
So there we go. I'll turn it over to Jonathan to very quickly run through some statistics and info on yesterday's fantastic workshop.
Thank you very much. Yesterday we had the tree and pest workshop in the Florence Library. We had a nice crowd. About 16 participants came out, which doesn't include the four Tree Northampton Associates that came in. So we really kind of hit our number. It was down actually by almost half. Although the library, we unexpectedly found out that we knew about the summer vacations, but the person who did their web and calendar and multimedia and posters left 2 weeks ago, so we didn't have any of that. So that makes me feel pretty good, because we still hit the numbers that I thought we'd get, but I was hoping as their participant that they'd help out. Actually, I have gone through and tabulated the surveys. We had 12 respondents to our survey. They all loved it. We had Ken Grush offer his perspective on this forest pastures. Actually, discussion was led by Nicole Kelleher.
Can you remind us the title of the presentation?
Tree Pests and Threats. That's actually the official was Common Massachusetts Tree Pests and Threats Version. So I can submit this document if you fellows like to read it. But the more importantly is this is a two-part program, the two educational programs that are linked. The first one was going to be pests. The second one was going to be a field trip to Worcester where we review the Asian longhorn beetle. And basically, as I write here, learn about how the outbreak is discovered, then controlled, view the impacts of the infestation, and learned how federal, state, and this whole non-governmental and private organizations came together for that crisis. So this is actually a program about preparedness, and we'd be looking at incident site command. Had a little experience with that up through Department of Defense and some Detroit. So I'm looking for a few more, I have a few more places left, and if anyone's interested, just put your email in the back of this, and I take questions.
For the field trip?
For the field trip.
Date and time?
Yeah.
It's 1 week, it's on Tuesday. We'll meet in, we'll meet Tuesday at 8:30 a.m. at the AFIS USDA headquarters, 151 Boylston Street. This is ready to be emailed to anybody who's interested. Just put your name on the back and I'll send you all the dope. It goes from 8:30 in the morning till 12:30. Well, depending on the weather. Weather's bad, you probably won't be out so long, you probably won't make time to any demonstrations. But we have several demonstration sites. Point of contact, the first tree, the ARIC disposal area, where we'll actually go through and see how they dispose of ALB. We're gonna go to sites that have been obliterated, that were all maple, all gone, replanting. And then another part that we're gonna do is something important that I wrote down. Can't remember the right time, I'm talking about. But it's a busy day, and it's next week on Tuesday, and that will be a wrap up. We'll wrap up with that, and one of the things, we learned a lot from this program. Anyone have any questions?
I know somebody who lives in Worcester in the area where a lot of those maples tend to be taken down, and the one upside of that is he said, now I can put solar panels on my house.
Sweet.
I don't think, because he didn't want to take down the trees to put the panels up, but once they were cleared.
Yeah.
Well.
Sky's the limit.
Unless they get the city replants them.
Yeah, but the downside is the first summer after all those trees came down, the average electricity bill for Worcester went up by 28%.
On the change.
Yeah.
For both heating and?
Yeah.
We should, yeah.
All right, well, thank you.
Thank you, John. Are there any notes that we're taking at that workshop? I meant to go to that, I just wanted to take it on my calendar.
Yeah, one of our participants asked, we actually ended up with a lot of gardeners, but the Master Gardener, which had three people, Western Mass Gardeners Association came, and they've asked for documentation on where they got the info from, so I'm going to make a letter for her.
I'd love to get whatever you can pass on.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Oh, we got the whole 9 yards. Okay.
You can put your email on back if you want.
Thank Jay Girard. He had mentioned about getting out to tree services, which I did get an earful with some of them. Like, why are you doing it in the summer? Do it in the winter.
And they came.
They gave me some great input on how to schedule a program. We had tree commissioner come, Henry Laban came over from Amherst. In fact, the type of information I did get from tree services will be planned, future programs on this. And it was very insightful. That'll be in the final report that I make once we get both these programs done and take a vacation.
The quality of the workshop was very good. Ken Gooch was there, tremendously knowledgeable. And he was very impressed that we had setback information. And
yeah,
he was very complimentary of the fact that we are doing setbacks for the health of our canopy.
Yeah, great. Yeah. All right, moving us along so we can get out of here before 6, or at least at 6. All right, so any other business, we're going to circle back to the Forbes Library. Rich, how would you like to do this? And let's limit this to 5 minutes. If we can, 5 to 7.
So basically, the meeting that we're going to have this Friday is to actually discuss with the subcommittee of the Board of Trustees put together to talk about the replacement of the trees that we're going to have to remove and what trees. I just want to give you an example. So the other trees that are on the library campus that are not under the city's jurisdiction, we had an arborist come and actually take a look at the work that has to be done. And the total work is $15,229. And that's for three removals.
On the scale of those big trees?
Yes. Yep. We have three removals, a couple of trims, and so just to give you an idea of what it costs to do that work, it's quite a
So for the purpose of moving this along, and for the purpose of no surprise that I have strong opinions, I'm going to share what my thoughts on this are, because I have thought about this. I have a really strong emotional attachment to those trees. Those trees are why I live in Northampton. Literally, I sat down at the base of those trees when I had my first child, a toddler, when we were scoping out communities, and I looked up at those trees and I said, I want to live in a community that cares about trees like that. And it's, you know, it's one of the reasons why I live here. So I feel that those trees are very special. And I think they're special because they're all the same species, and I feel they're special because they're all lined up in a row and that they're stately. And they're iconic that way. And so I would love to propose to the Forbes trustees that we replace the trees with a similar kind of iconic, stately tree, and hopefully one that is relatively fast growing so that we can get back to that shade that we will be sorely lacking. I mean, it'll be a huge impact when those trees come down. We know what it's like when shade trees come down. So, I mean, I love pin oaks, and I know that they're fast growing, and I know that there are other oak trees out there that may be better surviving, so I'm open to that, but I feel like out of respect for the history of those trees and the way they circle the library in this really beautiful way, I would love to replace them. I also, the last thing is that if Rich and Jay weigh in that we need to pull those trees back in terms of where they're planted in order to give them a better success rate vis-a-vis the wire, vis-a-vis any future work that they might do on the sidewalk or the roads, I'm in favor of that. So that's my view.
One thing that I would love to do, given just the impact that losing these trees is going to have on Northampton, is use it as an educational opportunity. Have an article in the Gazette, not blaming, but just explaining why these were damaged, because, you know, the road construction. So again, not to make anybody feel bad, but just use it as an educational opportunity. We're all gonna miss these trees. Let's not let this happen again.
No control.
Who's the state?
State can do whatever they want.
And the thing is,
I still think that we can shout it out, because,
well, also people are just gonna be wondering, why did they take those trees down?
Because if we aren't feel like it's a state project and we have no one to know the same in the matter, then we're just like, we must have some state.
Well, actually, MGL Chapter 87 says that for any road widening project, you can remove trees without a public hearing. So if the state decides, that, or the mayor decides, we're going to widen Hinkley Street to 55 feet, which is the only reason we can go down. And that's it.
I agree with Marilyn that it's still an opportunity to educate.
I don't disagree, and I think actually we need to do a little more than that. I think we need to make this a community project in a sense. This is one of my recommendations. My vote to the mayor was that we make this a community planning project, where we actually have a planning day just for Morris, where we actually have the trustees out there, and we have friends of the library, and anyone else that's interested in actually planting the replacement trees at Forbes to commemorate. I mean, the library is 117 years old, 119 years old, and those trees have been there all that time. And so I think it would be, if it's built in that way, the fact that it is such a historical, you know, such a piece of our history in Northampton, and it holds all of our history, and these trees hold a lot of history, so why not make it a day that is kind of, instead of lamenting the loss of the trees, make it more of a celebration about the trees that we were part of planting, that hopefully will last another 100 or some odd years, if not longer.
You're becoming a politician.
Mm-hmm. I'm not running for any office. I got enough work.
Okay, other thoughts?
I mean, it wasn't just the road widening, right?
Yes,
but the other side of it, when they were fixing the library, right, when they were doing all the repointing and all that stuff, if they would have just moved the access road, like everything was, that was their staging area, that's where they parked their trucks, that's where.
That killed two of the trees.
Yeah.
All the rest of them, because of the highway.
When they widened 66.
And they were giving some good advice, they just didn't listen.
Who's the say?
Or the library, when the access.
The director at that point just did not, he didn't care about trees. At least he didn't indicate, his behavior didn't.
I mean, probably not, but the other thing too is that, you know, dealing with the engineering part for many years and watching all the projects, and we've come such a long way in actually communicating with the engineer, that these, like, trees on Hinkley Street are being protected, air spading got written into the contract, you know, and I have to do all the inspections, and so we're so much farther ahead.
Yeah.
Those trees were called out originally that they were public shade trees, but the department didn't have, our department didn't have any vehicle at the time, there was no tree ward and so on and so forth, so. I don't think you would see that kind of thing happen again, but I agree with Jay that it was, man, the road widening, but the other thing I found by walking around the ground, the soil is so compacted everywhere. Even in the front of the library, when you first start going up the street, it's hard as rock, literally. Trying to push a probe in the ground, or trying to drive a stake in the ground.
All right, so let's try to think about, in the few minutes we have remaining, we have this meeting tomorrow with trustees.
Friday.
Oh, sorry, it's Friday, okay. Is there anything that a commissioner wants to provide in the way of recommendation to the three of us who are meeting with the trustees? I've said my piece.
Is this the time when you'd be discussing which trees would be replacing them?
Yeah, I mean, I would think so, I mean, I think, you know, we need to, again, the public shade tree hearing process has to happen, because I'd like to try to get these trees down before September, and I'm kind of at the mercy of National Grid to do the work over the highway utilities. I can do the other trees with our own crew, but I'd like to try to do it all at one time. As far as the tree, getting a decision about what types of trees we want to plant, that's also very important we get that decided shortly, because we have to refine them. That's good.
We put ourselves in so much more of a powerful position if we have suggested trees.
I think.
Then if we go into the conversation completely over.
No, I think the trustees are actually looking for guidance from us, direct guidance, and they're very willing to take our recommendations.
Can I put something out there on that thing?
Sure.
Over on the side where they have movies on that lawn, I think it's pretty far set back from roads and wires and things. I was thinking that might be a nice place to put a white oak, because they have those big spreading branches that would make a really nice shady area for people to sit.
So you're talking about?
On the other side of the driveway.
Okay.
Yeah. I think the other ones along the street should all be the same kind.
So just to give you a general reference, when you first drive into the entrance, the first two trees on the right-hand side will be removed.
Yeah.
The large one that's under 10 feet, that's virtually not, it's not dead, but it's dying. And the one that's right next to it, which is smaller, that has some damage that can't be.
Is there another tree that's on that side, but farther in?
There are other trees there, but they're not coming down.
Oh, okay.
I'm recommending a tree plant.
Okay.
What about the big one in the middle of the, to the left, which is driving in the driveway, there's one big one in the.
You can mark them.
Yeah, I can mark them with tags, when I have.
All right, does anyone have any strong objection, or even mild objection, to us recommending that the trees along the road be the same species?
As each other. Yes, I agree.
And that they be taken from our draft tree list, and that we would recommend distinctly fast-growing species.
Yeah.
Are there any, though, that we really don't want to steer them toward? Like, of what you just described?
Crab apples.
Stately crab apples?
And stately crab apples.
That they be taken from the large tree list.
All same species.
I think if possible, it would be nice if they were trees that were native and not exotic ones. No?
Or naturalized?
I
I don't know, just because, you know, the streets are tough spots, you know, it's, you know, people don't like, and I'm not suggesting anyone's, but, you know, I would suggest.
The soil conditions there are really poor.
It's bad, I mean, that's a harsh site, so.
Yeah, yeah, there's gonna have to be some.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, but I think that, you know.
Well, what do you think, what do you think it would be once it would be suitable?
See, I like the nice tall, a nice tall, straight pole.
It's what?
What about,
They're fast growing.
What about tulip trees, those are really fast growing.
I worry about tulip trees because they're such shallow.
Which ones, I'm saying, whether they're pinup or scarlet.
There's a couple there that I think are scarlet.
So if there are a couple that are scarlet, I would think you just shift over, they're hard to tell apart, and they're pruning might have been scarlet. Scarlet, which, I mean, if it's hard to tell which one it is, scarlet oaks are nice.
You like scarlet oaks better?
Yeah, me too.
And are they fast growing?
Yeah, they're hard to distinguish from a pinup, but they do.
I think I have a scarlet, I think I planted scarlet oak over my yard, and it is, I mean, it's got a very different habit. I mean, pinups have a very distinguished habit in the early stages of that.
Right, right.
Of that jumping jack, if quality.
Yeah.
And scarlet oaks do not have that, correct?
Correct. And that's all part of the pinups, the way they grow, they're nightmare.
Do you have a strong feeling one way or the other?
I personally like scarlet oaks, I think they're a native tree, they've been around, they're very durable.
Are pinups not a native?
No, they are, it's just that they are just, we have a scarlet oak. I just think we have a lot of pinups.
Okay.
We plant a lot of pinups all over the place.
And how are they to urban conditions?
They're doable.
I think we're converging on something here, and does anyone have an objection to us recommending that we replace the current pinups with scarlet oaks, roughly the same number? Maybe pull back a little bit?
With just the addition that I need, Molly's idea of possibly having a way to do that.
Okay, well, is that outside of our purview? That's not really the discussion.
The problem is that we won't, you know, we can make a, so if eventually the other trees in the campus will have to come down, so that'll be the opportunity to actually plant different species of trees that are in the back.
Oh, okay.
But we are only limited to, we can give the recommendations and say, move this back on your property, but by the way, you're gonna be completely responsible for it.
I was thinking of the tree, I'm just thinking, I think there's a tree that's sort of back away from the road. But I'm not sure.
You mean the ones that you and I?
Near the place where you're, no, where you sit to watch the movies or when there's a concert.
Before you get to the park.
I think a big oak there on the right, or, that's what I was thinking.
We can throw that out as a suggestion, but it sounds like that's not what we're actually gonna talk about. We're maybe to talk about the ones along there.
Correct.
Okay, all right. Any other, because we're now, it's 6 o'clock. Can we feel good about this recommendation? Okay, I don't think this requires a vote, does it?
No.
Okay, all right. Quick to-do list.
Okay, here we go. Rich's gonna reach out to Ryan to get traffic calming manual. Oh, tonight, I'm sorry. You already did, all right.
Check it out.
All right.
I haven't delivered yet.
All right, love that, drafting. Provide a breakdown of the 2017 tree planting to put a map if possible. Pass by Alan for approval of the public tree impact permit. Terry's gonna send a list of roads recommended for traffic calming to everyone. And meet along with Lily and Jay with the Board of Library Trustees on Friday the 18th. Lily's gonna reach out to Wayne regarding the bike head held out, changes to that. Get updated draft of traffic calming manual from Rich once it gets back. See, Todd's gonna draft a language for the traffic calming manual, include
data-driven studies or citations, and revise the tree impact permit, make sure it aligns with CBT tree ordinance, change the average super fake foliage, and get it pointed out. And see Jen regarding the guide, include a how to use this guide at the beginning, add column for pages, and why we're using it, the Vermont trees selection guide, and include vegetation. That was it.
Thank you very much. Motion to adjourn this meeting.
Is it, would you like to end the motion?
Someone's got to make that motion. You, how about, you can say so moved.
So moved.
Second. All right, all in favor?